And everyone, good afternoon, Manasi, and welcome to this webinar in which we have the honor and the pleasure of having the leading presence of Indian classical vocalist Manasi Prasad, who is the director of the Indian Music Experience Museum, based in the Indian city of Bangalore, Bengaluru. And she will tell us about the diversity and history of music in India. And she will also take a deeper look at the core musical concepts in Indian classical music, such as raga, tala, composition, and improvisation with a practical demonstration. Good afternoon, Manasi. You promise us making a practical demonstration on vocal music too. So we are excited about that. We have here a specialist in jazz, vocal music. She's very interested in, and our students too. So please, I give Monica the place to just start officially the thanks and everything about this organization and this activity. Please, Monica.
Hello, everyone. Good morning or good afternoon, depending on where you are. My name is Monica Fernandez. I am the secretary of the Spanish Association for the Interdisciplinary Study of India, long name. I'd just like to say a few words to thank everyone who's made this event possible, especially Manasi Prasad. Thank you very much for being here. We are very humbled and very, very grateful. And also Enrique, Cámara, thank you very much for organizing this wonderful event. Enrique is in the classroom with his students. So it's going to be, I think, an amazing experience, as I was telling Manasi before, a mixture between a communal experience, but we also have the opportunity to speak with someone who's a few kilometers away. So I'd just like to thank the Embassy of India and the Ministry of Culture for making, for supporting our activities and making them possible. And of course, the other members of the association, especially the president, Antonio Navarro Tejero, who's unable to be here today, who make all this possible. Without all the members who contribute to the activities, the people who we invite, the help of the embassy, and also obviously the attendees as well, this wouldn't be possible. So our heartfelt thanks to everyone who's present here today, either virtually or spiritually. Some will also, there's some hidden help always behind all these events, and we are grateful that a lot of people will be able to continue seeing this in our YouTube channel. So that said, I think it's time to begin this event. The floor is yours.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Manasi. Thank you, Monica. I would like to say some things before too. Okay, I say thanks to the, for sure, and the Asociación Española de Estudios Interdisciplinarios sobre India, Spanish Association for Interdisciplinary Studies of India. Thank you, Antonia Navarro. Thank you, Monica. Thank you, the treasurer, Luz, and the team that collaborated in organizing this event. Also, thank you to Rosanna, who designed the poster. Thank you, everyone. This poster has been sent to the members of the Spanish Association for Interdisciplinary Studies of India, but also to the authorities of the University of Valladolid, the Vice Rector of the International Relations, Paloma Castro, who is active in India, and the Vice Rector for Communication and University Extension, Carmen Baquera, on which depends the Aula de Musica that makes publication of music from India. And we have sent it to some organizations and scientists linked to musicological research. Asociación Argentina de Musicología, Argentine Association of Musicology, Asociación Española de Musicología, Spanish Society of Musicology, CIBE, Society of Ethnomusicology, ICTM LATCAR, which is the study group of the International Council for Traditional Music, and ARLAC, which belongs to the IMS, International Musicological Society. So this webinar is part of a series of activities scheduled by the Spanish Association for Interdisciplinary Studies of India for this current academic period. The realization of these activities has been possible. Thanks again, the ambassador, Sri Sanjay Verma, that was the ambassador until some time ago, and then the current ambassador, Sri Dinesh Patnaik, thank you very much. So I would like to say something to our students, which are here in the Aula 6, in the sixth room of the Faculty of Philosophy and Letters, because we have chosen this day and this time in order to coincide with the class of the World Musical Tradition subject, whose content program includes an approach to some of the musical cultures of India, China, Japan, Indonesia, Tibet, Mongolia, Arabic Islamic cultures of Sub-Saharan Africa and America. I apologize to the students that the classes dedicated to India are not scheduled for this month, but for the later. If I am not mistaken, Professor Matias Isolabella have started with Sub-Saharan Africa because you have to do some exercise, some presentation on some written presentation about this. And because of this, I have asked Manasi Prasad to make, in the beginning, in the starting a presentation about classical traditions in India. So traditional music, which in India means the classical tradition, before she goes to other topics. I will read a very brief version of her resume that will allow you to notice that she's a very professional, especially competent for staying today with us in this meeting. Manasi has learned Carnatic classical music from renowned gurus such as Padmanabha in Bangalore and Sriram Parasuram in Chennai, in Madras. She has performed widely across India and in all continents around the world. She is a recipient of several awards in music, including the prestigious Bishmilat Khan Yuva Purashkar from the Sangeet Natak Academy, the most important institution in India for music. And she is an engineering graduate. She went on to do her MBA, Master in Administración de Empresas, from the Indian Institute of Management in Bangalore. And she has been awarded a fellowship by the TAD organization, Technology, Entertainment and Design, and has been recognized as one of the 35 Indians of tomorrow by the Indian Today publication. Nada menos, en un país con 1,400 millones de habitantes. In her role as director of the Indian Music Experience Museum, Manasi conceptualized and led a team that curated the 9 permanent exhibits of this institution, and she continues to lead the museum activities. She also co-curated the Ravi Shankar at 100 India Global Musician. You know, this is a centennial, that was the centennial of his birth, Ravi Shankar's birth. So she opened this in the museum in 2020. She has been involved in reviving the composition of violin maestro Mysore Chodia and has prepared a web online digital archive of his lives and works. She also has striven to pivot the museum to a larger community orientation with projects for children from disadvantaged backgrounds. I want to tell the students here that they have a course on applied ethnomusicology in their curriculum. So for this reason, I invite you to take advantage of Manasi Prasad's presence here and ask her everything you want to ask. If you need some translation, sometimes you just ask me, Matias, or no sé si está por aquí, Claudia. She says English is very much better than mine. So in order just to... okay, for sure. For sure. So, last thing I tell you, last year during the course Culture, Arts and Society of India, which we organized with the Buendía Center of the University of Valladolid, Casa de la India and Embassy of India in Spain, some students asked for the topic of popular music in India today, which I don't know absolutely. So I consulted with Guillermo Rodriguez, director of Casa de la India, and he had the happy idea of advising me to contact Manasi Prasad. She gave a splendid class on this complex and varied subject. And for this reason, we have invited her now, because it is not easy to find a professional specialist in classical music and also a profound connoisseur of popular music too. So thank you again, Manasi, for being here. And if you allow me, I ask you to start your conversation perhaps by telling us something about this diversity of musical traditions, classic and folk, pop, in this big subcontinent of India. So we are listening to you. Thanks again.
Gracias. And buenos días. Estoy muy feliz de estar aquí. Espero disfruten esta presentación. And that's all the Spanish I know. I hope with that. As is tradition, I will begin. I would like to include as much music as I can through this presentation. So as is tradition, I will begin with a short salutation to Lord Ganesha, the remover of all obstacles. And then we will continue with the presentation.
वक्रतुंड महाकाय सूर्यकोटि समप्रभा निर्विघ्नं कुरु मे देव सर्वकार्येषु सर्वदा गजाननं भूतगणादिसेवितं कपित्तजम्बूफलसारभक्षितं ओमासुतं शोकविनाशकारणं नमामि विघ्ने ईश्वर पाद पंकजम्
So with that salutation to Ganesha, we will begin the presentation. And before I begin, I wanted to say, of course, my thanks to Professor Enrique Cámara. I have a great regard for him and his scholarship and for his work in building these bridges between India and Spain musically. I'm really honored and humbled to be here, and I hope what I have to share with all of you will be useful. So the way I have structured this is that I thought we are at 4:50 p.m., which I think is about 12:20 p.m. in Spain, where you are. So I thought I would do a presentation and interspersed with music, etc., for about 70 minutes, a little more than an hour, so that I leave about 15 or 20 minutes for question and answers. Would that be okay, Professor Cámara? Yes?
This is okay for us. Thank you very much for doing that.
Perfect. And in the meanwhile, I can't interact with all the students who are there, but please feel free to sort of use the chat window. You could convey to Professor Cámara if you had any questions as we go along. And I'll be happy to answer them either during the course of the presentation or following that. All right. So with that, let's begin. So this is the title of my presentation, The Music of India, Classical and Beyond. Now, before we begin with the subject of the presentation, one of the things that I like to do is set the context as to why do we need to understand music of any country, for that matter. And I think, I know you are all music students, but even beyond that, I think there is a very fundamental purpose to understanding music. So I wanted to spend a few minutes talking about that and then get into the agenda of the presentation. And the reason for that is what I like to call so that we can break some cultural stereotypes, right? Every culture has been stereotyped, perhaps increasingly so these days because of the presence of social media, because of Hollywood, because of all the content that we get fed to us in bite-sized quantities. And because of that, I'm sure many of you may have some cultural stereotypes about what India is all about, right? I would love to hear from you, but you know, I've heard from people that, you know, one of the stereotypes about India, especially in the 80s and the 90s, was this character called Appu from The Simpsons, who had a very strong Indian accent, and he ran a convenience store. You know, there were some very strong stereotypes associated with India through him. And then later on, I don't know if any of you have watched this show called The Big Bang Theory, which had this character who's a software engineer, he's a techie, again, a stereotype associated with India that everybody nowadays is a software engineer. And you know, some of you may have seen this actress, her name is Priyanka Chopra, and she's quite a global superstar now. And many people may think that all Indians look like her, but unfortunately they don't. And there are other stereotypes as well, like Mahatma Gandhi, you know, non-violence, ahimsa. So, you know, when I was thinking of what I stereotype Spain as, you know, some of the images which would come to my mind are flamenco dancers, matadors, everybody plays tennis or badminton, paella. So we have all these images of a country that we have in our minds. Now, when it comes to a country like India, it's very difficult because India is a very diverse country, right? It has 1.4 billion people and it has among the largest number of illiterate adults, but it also produces a huge number of technically qualified people. It has a large number of houses which don't even have basic facilities like a toilet, but the second largest number of cell phone users. The richest house in the world and some of the poorest dwellings in the world. It has the cheapest car in the world, and an Indian company also owns the most expensive car, or not the most expensive, among the more expensive cars in the world, right? So these are some mind-boggling numbers about India. And the question is, how do you make sense of a country as diverse as India? And I'm sure all of us being associated with music would believe this, what Paulo Coelho said, which is that it is through culture. And when I say culture, I mean art and culture, right? That we can understand each other better. So beyond the idea of studying music, beyond ethnomusicology, I believe that understanding about music actually makes us understand each other better. And that, I believe, is the purpose of such interactions musically and otherwise. So with that, I hope I have convinced you why you should pay attention to this presentation. And the agenda that I will be following in this presentation is like this. So first, what we'll do is we'll look at Indian music in general, right? All these diverse forms, genres, how do you understand this entire diversity of music? I'd like to talk a little bit about some of the core concepts, right? You know, India also has a large number of musical instruments. How do you categorize? How do you sort? How do these relate to the rest of the world? And then we look at some concepts of Indian classical music. And finally, what I'd like to do is a practical demonstration where I'll take a Carnatic composition and I'll break it up into the constituent elements in the hope that you will understand it a little better. I hope that's okay. I can see many of you in the class. If that's okay, can you give me a thumbs up? That would be great. Okay, I see some double thumbs up. That's good. Am I speaking too fast or is it okay? It's good? Is it good?
Yes.
Okay. Perfect, perfect. That's good. That's good for everyone.
All right. Perfect. So let's go on then to the first part, which is India's music landscape. And here, why am I qualified to speak about this subject? Because I spent about 10 years. I don't have a degree in music, a formal education in music like some of you, even though I've spent a lot of my life learning music in the traditional guru, shishya tradition of learning. But what makes me perhaps uniquely qualified to talk about this is I spent 10 years curating India's first music museum, the Indian Music Experience Museum. So I'd like to give you a quick glimpse of what the IME looks like. I hope this will excite you to come and visit when you come to this part of the world. So here goes a 1 minute clip on the IME. Realize the music for that was not very Indian, but I hope it gave you a glimpse of what the IME looks like. So I'm going to move on from here. Yeah. So let's look at these three questions out of the five W's and the H, who, what, when, where, why, and how. I have picked three questions that I would like to ask and answer, which I hope will help you understand more about Indian music. The first is, what are the kinds of music in India? There is so much diversity. So how do you sort of at least put some frameworks around these forms of music? Second, let's look at a little bit of the history. Again, there is no one Indian music because there are so many Indian musics. Having said that, we can look a little bit at the history of at least Indian classical and the allied forms. The third question is, how is music made? And this is where I'll talk a little bit about the instruments. Okay. So here's the part where we listen to some samples of Indian music and try to sort of understand where they fit into the overall framework. Now, the overall framework of Indian music in some ways falls into what we call the axiomatic triangle of art music, folk music, and popular music. Now, this is a construct that is perhaps used in many musical cultures. And we can also use this framework to try and understand the the musical genres and how they are how they fit and how they are related to each other, right? So in India also, as I said, you have art music forms, you have popular music forms, and you have folk music forms, and then you have a lot that come in the middle as well, because I'm sure you all agree that music cannot be put into airtight or watertight buckets. They all flow into each other, and genres tend to meld and merge into each other. Having said that, as I said, when you talk about the art music in India, there are two main forms of music, art music, that is Hindustani and Carnatic classical music in the north and the south respectively. And then you have folk music forms, which are, we'll get to the definitions later. which are, so folk music is all around, you know, every community has it, every language, every region of the country has various folk music genres or forms. And then you have popular music, which in India is really defined. In fact, popular culture in India is defined by the music of film, right? Bollywood. I'm sure you all know of Bollywood. And a lot of popular culture, you know, way people dress, you know, the music, the dance, the colors, fashion trends, wedding themes, everything takes from Bollywood. And now you also have, you know, what Professor Enrique Cámara mentioned, what I talked about last time, which was really other contemporary forms of music that combine Indian influences from that around the world. So let's listen to just some quick samples and try and identify what forms of music these are. Okay, so here we begin.
Oh!
रूप तेरा सोना सोनी तेरी पायल हे रूप तेरा सोना सोना सोनी तेरी पायल छन छना छन ऐसे छन के कर दे सबको घायल कह रहा आंखों का काजल इश्क में जीना मरना ये से शावा शावा माहिया से शावा शावा माहिया से शावा शावा माहिया से शावा शावा
सो एनी गेसेस एज टू व्हाट फॉर्म ऑफ म्यूजिक दिस इज
¿Qué les parece qué música es? They say popular. Yes. Which kind of popular? Film music, perhaps Bollywood?
Yes, absolutely. So you're right. This is what we call film music in India. It's it is the most ubiquitous or most widely heard, played, paid form of music in India. And it, as I said, it defines popular culture. What's interesting from a musicological perspective is that film music is not a genre. It doesn't have any defining characteristics about the music because it's a melting pot of various genres. So you have a filmy version of a classical composition. You have a filmy version of a folk song. You even have filmy Hindi film versions of Spanish songs and, you know, flamenco or Arabic music. Everything finds its way into this melting pot that we loosely call it as Bollywood, but what's important to note here is Bollywood refers to the Hindi film industry based in Mumbai, which is probably most widely heard and everything like that. But there is also Tollywood, Collywood, Mollywood, Sandalwood and beyond. So every language in India has its own film industry, right? Telugu, Bengali, Tamil, Malayalam, Kannada. So each language and each sort of state, linguistic state, has its own film music. They share certain common characteristics, and one of the most common characteristics is that of this concept of playback singing, right? So the person that you saw on the screen dancing is not the person who has sung the song. There are specialized singers called playback singers who sing these songs, and then the actors just act and dance them out on screen. Okay, moving on. That's a beautiful rendition of What form of music? Would anybody like to take a guess?
What kind of music is that?
Art music,
eh? For the South, Carnatic, very well.
Absolutely. Yep.
They say that.
Yes. So this was part of what we call as, you know, while it is, yes, it is art music in a musicological sense, it is referred to as classical music. And the form, there are, as I said, there are two main forms of classical music in India, which is Carnatic music in the south and Hindustani music in the rest, north, east and west of the country. So what is classical music? Classical music is, of course, has certain, I wouldn't like to call them rules because even these rules change over time. However, I would like to call them conventions, right? There are some established conventions by which compositions are created. There is a lot of improvisation. However, this improvisation is also governed by certain conventions or frameworks. Both these forms of music share common roots, which we'll look at in the history. But they're also different from each other, right? Why are there two different systems of music? Because they differ in the intonation and the compositions, the forms of the compositions, what are the kinds of instruments used. For example, what you saw earlier was Carnatic music, where you had, that was a vocal performance with a mridangam, a two-headed drum, and a violin, which is very popularly used in South Indian classical music. Whereas in Hindustani or North Indian music, as you see in this picture here, the instruments, this is of course a picture of the renowned global sitar maestro Pandit Ravi Shankar, who played a stringed instrument, the sitar, accompanied by Alla Rakha, who was a legendary tabla player, a percussion instrument. And Alla Rakha was the father of Zakir Hussain, who is perhaps the best known Indian percussionist globally. Both are, of course, fall under the category of art music, and they do have a deep spiritual sense. Now, partly this is because the subject matter of the compositions are, especially in Carnatic music, overtly devotional. They are addressed to a particular god from the Hindu pantheon. But not all compositions are overtly devotional. However, there is a deep sense of spirituality in the approach to the music, where sound itself is God. So you refer to sound as nada in Sanskrit. And sound is almost considered a personification of the divine. We say nada Brahma, where Brahma is one of the trinity of the Hindu god, the pantheon. And so nada Brahma gives the sense of sound being God. So there is a deep reverence with which, you know, music is approached. Okay, now let's listen to another form of music which has some common characteristics with the previous thing that we heard, piece of music that we heard. What form of music is this? And there's another, I'm giving you another example of this sort of category of musical forms.
Oh,
sort of talk about what do you think are common, or what did you feel about these forms of music? Did you notice anything about them?
Yes. Ayúdame, que estoy un poco sordo.
Sí, no, preguntaba si eran de estas o dos últimas.
¿Ah, sí? Sí, sobre esta.
¿Qué pensás que es?
What do you think about? Folk music and... They have some doubts about the second example.
Okay. So, this is one of those sort of, you know, which you can't fit quite into that axiomatic triangle, because it shares a lot in common with both the classical as well as the folk, kind of components. And so we loosely call them regional music traditions. And a lot of these, what was characteristic about both those forms of music is they are both overtly religious. The first one is what is called the Abhang or Varkari tradition, where it's congregational singing. There is, of course, improvisation by a main singer, but there is congregational singing, music bringing people together in this sort of devotional ecstasy, right? And the second, type of music that you heard there was similarly a devotional form of music from the Islamic tradition, right? It's called Sufi Qawwali. And Sufi is a mystic dimension of Islam where, the idea of reaching the salvation is through music, is through love. And in Sufism, music is a very important component as opposed to the rest of Islam. So we can group these sort of overtly devotional forms of music together as just broadly called regional devotional music traditions, because these are very much associated with particular regions of the country. And they're, of course, in various languages and, you know, represent various religions, etc. Okay. And then we'll move on to another form. So any guesses as to what of those three categories this would fit into?
¿Alguna idea?
Art.
She said perhaps art.
Well, again, it's interesting because, yes, there are some components of art in it. And the reason for that being that the roots of classical music do lie in folk traditions. But this is actually what we call Janapada Gite, or folk songs of the region that I am from, Karnataka. And you can see strong drumming, rhythmic sort of components. So this is actually one of the thousands and thousands of folk music forms that are found all around the country. And again, they all share characteristics, so it's very difficult to say what is folk, what is classical, what is art. But, you know, some of the characteristics I would say are they're intimately linked to a particular community or a particular region. They're both performative and participatory. See, art music, as you all know, exists as, either art for art's sake, right? It's not serving necessarily a devotional or a ritual or a certain rite of passage kind of context. Whereas folk music, a lot of these songs are very participatory, where, you know, you'll find an entire community joining together to sing, where it's not necessarily as a performance art. It's often intertwined with dance. And It's related to particular themes or contexts. For example, at the IME, we've looked at four different contexts in which music is made. The first is, you know, what we talked about, rites of passage from birth to death. You have songs for people when kids are born, when puberty is attained, a whole lot of wedding songs, up to even funerary songs, right? So songs for every stage of life. You have songs for every profession, like the cobbler songs, the boatman songs, the fisherman songs. And this would help especially when a group of people are performing a task together, right? Like sowing seeds or winnowing or rowing a boat together. These folk songs would be used to share a common rhythm. And you also have songs related to different festivals. You have songs about heroes and gods. So I thought enough speaking now. I'd like to sing a little bit of a folk form called the Bihu Geet. Now, the Bihu Geet is particularly sung in the harvest season in the northeast part of the country. And it is often associated with dancing. So what I'm going to do is I'm just going to use this for visual effect, but I'm going to sing because the song here is not quite a traditional Bihu Geet. So I will sing and you can watch the visuals alongside it. It follows a very particular rhythm, a 3-4 kind of time signature. I don't know if that corresponds exactly with the 3-4 signature in Western music, but the 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3, 1-2-3 kind of beat where the first and second beats are highlighted. So it's got a very particular Bihu rhythm that you can notice. So just give me a second while I set this up. Okay, I don't think I can play sound differently and the movie separately. So I will just sing a little bit and then I'll show you a little bit of the dance. So give me 1 second. Okay, now I'm going to share the computer sound. So hopefully you should be able to listen to this.
Bihu bihu lage se ga bihu maru ahana uru uru kori se mon epak nasu ahana sinu sinu lage tomar nam ki tomar kuana bihu maru ahana epak nasu ahana nam ki tomar kuana jaan bihu bihu lage se ga bihu maru ahana uru uru kori se mone pak nasu ahana sinu sinu lage tomar nam ki tomar kuana bihu maru ahana epak nasu ahana nam ki tomar kuana ja o nasani nasin jai bihu bite paki ga Bihu bite baki ga, Bihu bite baki ga. Chiyur mohore ke pati gati lo, ahur tolo te mon phal phal no kalo. Chiyur mohore ke pati gati lo, ahur tolo te mon phal phal no kalo. Nasi ja Bihu bite paki ga O guri guri nata ga Bihu bihu lagi se ga Bihu maru ahana Uru uru ko stories nin mon epak nasu ahana in musminu lage to manam ki tumar kuwana bihu maru ahana epak nasu ahana nam ki tumar kuwana ja.
So that was a little bit of a bihu geet, what it sounds like. And now I'll go back. Thank you. So that was in a pentatonic scale, as perhaps you would refer to, you know. You would hear, you know, sa na 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 na. Shares some similarities perhaps with the music of the Far East, right? A lot of, you know, some of Chinese music, I would not say all, follows this pentatonic scale. But again, I know that's a gross oversimplification of the music of China, so I do not want to sort of generalize that. But certainly perhaps because of the northeast of the country being close to China, there are some commonalities that are shared. I'm trying to go back now to my PowerPoint presentation. Yes. So what does a bihu dance look like? Yeah, so these are some of the traditional sort of bihu geet steps that you would see. With that, let's move on. And then finally, we come to, let's listen to this last bit of music, which is kind of a really interesting amalgamation of various influences. That's coming out of India, which is strongly rooted in a certain context and, you know, certainly has influences of traditional, you know, folk music, especially very strongly here. But it's also combined with a whole lot of global influences. It's very produced music, you know, with influences of hip hop and, you know, perhaps a little bit of EDM and, you know, other sort of very contemporary sounds that's coming, you know, out of the world. So without sort of dwelling too much on this, because I did a whole lecture on this last time round, you know, there's this entire subject called contemporary Indian music, which is really where all the action is today, right? Young people who are taking traditional music, interpreting it in new ways, you know, which sound both global yet Indian at the same time. And, you know, it's largely called, of course, independent music, because Bollywood music is the music industry in India and anything outside that is referred to as indie. And again, you know, draws on a wide range of influences, speaks to the youth and still evolving. So, you know, there's fusion, there's rock, pop, electronica, all kinds of genres under this, but we'll broadly call them contemporary Indian music, but I will not dwell too much on this. Okay. So to sum up this section where I talked about the diversity of Indian music, what are some of the characteristics that tie all these forms of music together, right? Again, these are all generalizations, so there are exceptions to the rule, but one would say A large part of Indian music is melodic or monophonic, as opposed to the harmony, which is the basis of Western traditions. So Eastern music being melodic or monophonic and Western being based on harmony is one of these age-old general sort of rules of thumb that we have. Of course, we all know there are exceptions on both sides, right? But a large part of Indian music lays strong emphasis on melody, and we'll talk more about that later. If you would have noticed, I did include mainly pieces of music which have a vocal component. Now, does that mean that there are no instrument-only music in India? Certainly not, as we saw with Pandit Ravi Shankar and many other, legendary musicians who've come out of India. Music which has only instruments is certainly a part of the ecosystem. But I would say that the vocal element forms a very key defining characteristic of a lot of Indian music traditions. So even, for example, when a sitar is being played or a violin is being played, there are strong influences of vocal music in terms of the compositions that are presented or certain ways that the notes will be embellished, right? So I would say there's a strong emphasis on vocal traditions, but that's not the only one. Improvisation is a key component of a lot of genres, be it the devotional genres, be it folk, be it classical. Perhaps besides the popular, Bollywood sort of music which is produced, everything else lays a strong emphasis on improvising on the spot, which is something that, it shares in common with jazz as well. And we'll talk a little bit about the improvisation, especially in classical music. Lastly, oral transmission, right? There's very little of a standardized notation system in India, like you have, the Western staff notation, which is pretty much, an accepted standard. Whereas in India, because over the centuries, music has been passed on from guru, the teacher, to the student, mainly orally, where the student spends hours and hours with the teacher and learns through listening and repetition, mainly. So there is no standardized form of notation, even though there are books published, etc. But the emphasis on oral tradition is very strong. So this brings me sort of to the end of one part of this presentation. And I just wanted to pause here and ask, did you have any questions, any observations, or do you want to keep them for the end?
Preguntas.
Preguntas. And from the chat too, please. If someone who is online want to ask something to Manasi, please. I think the moment is now. Okay, they are deciding to ask you a question after that. After you. Yes.
Yeah, I prefer it that way too. So let's move on to the next part, which I'm not going to go into too much detail, but the question of the history. When did Indian music begin? If there is, as we know, there is nothing called Indian music. There are many, many, many forms of Indian music. So when did it begin? So when it comes to sort of what is the most ancient form of music in India, it would certainly be the folk music traditions, as is true perhaps of any musical culture in the world. Song or singing or music making has existed perhaps since the beginning of mankind, right? So folk traditions have always been there, and there is no way to put a history or saying this is when it started. Certainly when it comes to popular music, you can point out, right? Because popular music is recorded music. So, for example, the Bollywood sort of talkie era started in the 1930s. And since then, there have been songs, and contemporary genres have probably started over the last 30 or 40 years since globalization, liberalization brought in, these influences from around the world. The one form of music where there is a exact timeline, or at least a sense of a timeline, is in classical music, right? Where one can pinpoint certain eras and developments. Like you have, of course, in Western classical music as well, right? With the classical era, Baroque, and, Renaissance, and those kind of eras. Similarly, with Indian classical music, you do have a timeline. So I don't know how visible this will be. It's quite small. I took a screenshot of one of the walls in the Indian Music Experience Museum. So if you want to read the details, please come to Bangalore. But the very first sort of record or treatise of music is the Natya Shastra, which is written by sage Bharata, somewhere between 500 BC and 500 AD. However, even before that was what we call the Vedic period, right? In Indian Hindu philosophy, there are these four texts and associated rituals of the Hindu tradition, which are called the Vedas. And these Vedas would be recited in a particular way. And again, this has been passed down through oral transmission. And it is said that the Vedic chanting was where the first beginnings of organized music began. So how is Vedic chanting? What does it sound like? So I'll sort of share a little bit of it. Again, I'll go to sound share only. So there are various sort of shlokas or verses. And these the ones that I'm reciting today are from the one of the Upanishads or subtexts of the Vedas. So it's like chanting. And each of these Vedic texts have a message. Like the first one says, from darkness to light, from immortality to immortality, from untruth unto truth, let us go. That is the message. The second one talks about learning and let the teacher and the student learn together. So I'll just sort of show you what a reciting of Vedas sounds like. That. One second. So that is sort of some of the shlokas from the Upanishads. And of course, there are different ways that the Vedas are chanted. In particular, the Sama Veda, the third Veda, is sung musically. And this is one of the original, as I said, recorded in terms of a treatise, evidences of organized music. And then, as I said, one moves across the various eras. What I really wanted to point out on this timeline is that you can see there is a clear split between the North Indian and South Indian classical music that happened between the 12th and 14th centuries. Now, why did that happen? Both forms of classical music can be traced back to Bharata's Natya Shastra, and they share a lot of characteristics in common. But what happened was that the north of India had a lot of political upheaval, right? There were invaders from Central and West Asia. First, the Arabian invaders, and then came the Mughals. And this was not just a political incoming influence, but also a cultural incoming influence, right? The the new rulers brought with them their musical instruments, their language, various musical influences as well. So in the north of India, there was an amalgamation of traditional Indian music with influences from Persia, resulting in what is Hindustani music today. So some of the characteristics, not all Hindustani music is overtly, related to a particular god of the Hindu pantheon. You have songs about monsoon, you have songs about a love and one's beloved. And you have, of course, different languages, influences of Persian and Urdu in the texts. Whereas, and in the instruments as well, right? Of course, the sitar is an amalgamation of a traditional Indian lute as well as Persian influences as well. There is sehtar, which is a Persian instrument. And while the Indian sitar is different from the sehtar, certainly there are links. Similarly with the tabla. Some say it was brought to India by Amir Khusro, or it was invented by Amir Khusro, an important personage in the Delhi courts. But certainly there were traditional Indian instruments combined with these influences from Persia and West Asia that resulted in, the music of North India. Whereas the music in South India, Carnatic music, continued to retain sort of its original forms and structures because it was less subject to politically influences from outside India. Is there a question? Sorry, I was not able to hear that.
¿Alguna pregunta sobre esto? ¿Algo que no se entienda? Some question?
Okay, let me keep moving on in the interest of time. But, if somebody raises their hand or has an observation, please feel free to do that. So then we come to the third question in the who, in the where, when and how. So how is music made? So here I just wanted to quickly talk about musical instruments, because that's a very important part of understanding Indian music, is to understand the various instruments that are used in Indian music, right? And of course, like anywhere in the world, body percussions, body rhythms were perhaps the first way that, sound making started. And today we have, instruments from the, most simple to perhaps some of the very intricate musical instruments around the world. So I thought this would be a good time for us to pause and look at IME's instruments gallery. I think you caught a glimpse of it. But here, for those of you who are interested, we have a 3D virtual walkthrough in IME's website. So let me just share a quick glimpse of the musical instrument gallery at the IME. Let me pause it, and you can probably look. There are instruments up to the roof and down to the bottom. We have nearly 108 instruments displayed in this gallery. So clearly you can see they belong to various categories. So I encourage you to explore. If you would like to know a little bit more about the musical instruments of India, you can visit our website. And inbuilt in this is also a sort of interactive that will tell you a lot more about the musical instruments that we have in India. But let's come back to, some of the principles behind these musical instruments. As you all know, this is basic physics, that sound is produced because of vibration traveling through a medium. Now, based on what it is that vibrates, musical instruments are classified. So I just wanted to sort of give you an idea of how musical instruments are classified in India. And you will see that this corresponds very much with musical instrument classification around the world, right? So you have stringed instruments called tatavadya, wind instruments, sushiravadya. And when it comes to percussion, there are actually two forms. One is membranophones and one is idiophones. You may have studied instrument classification, but the idea of chordophones, aerophones, membranophones and idiophones is a form of musical instrument classification that exists around the world. So we'll do a quick quiz here. Of course, there's a fifth form of musical instrument, I'm sure. Does anybody have a guess what you call instruments like the theremin or synthesizers?
How you call this kind of instrument like theremin, ondas? Electrophone, perhaps.
Yeah, absolutely. So, of course, we haven't had that characterization in India because these classifications exist back to Bharata's Natya Shastra, and clearly there was no electricity then, or whatever, electronics then. So, as per the Indian system of classification, where would we fit an instrument like the piano? Where do you fit an instrument like the piano? What would you call it in the Western system? Is it a stringed instrument or a idiophone?
String instrument, right?
Mm-hmm. Right. So I think in the Indian system, of course, there is a little, because there are hammers inside which strike these reeds. So technically, this would put it in a ghanavadya or in an idiophone, because it's two solid objects striking against each other. However, I guess yes, the general classification would be as a stringed instrument. And just out of curiosity, what would we call the human voice? After all, the human voice is an instrument too. So any suggestions for where we can place? This is not related to Indian music, but just a sort of something to think about.
¿Qué categoría lo pondría? Which category?
Idiophone.
Aerophone?
Yeah, so I think, again, the jury is out on this one. Some say, of course, it's an aerophone because, sound is amplified in the, air passages, the nasal and oral cavities. Having said that, the vocal cords are actually membranes which are vibrated because of the air passing through. So membranophone, I think the jury is out on that one. So it's difficult perhaps to categorize, but certainly maybe we'll stick with aerophone for now. So it's quiz time. You can take a look and tell me what category do you think. This is also sort of knowing a little more about Indian musical instruments. So what kind of instruments? Fairly obvious, I think, right? I'm sure you know what kind of instrument it is.
Okay. Say it. Yeah. Loud. Yeah. Yes.
It's a stringed instrument. I'm just doing this to have a little bit of interaction. This is an instrument called the taus or the mayuri. And I don't know why the names are not coming, but it's called the taus. Taus means peacock. And it's obviously inspired by the shape of a peacock. Very much used in a devotional form of music from the Punjab region called Gurbani or Sikh Shabad Kirtan. All right. What form of instrument do you think this is?
Phone or membranophone?
Yes, this is a membranophone. As we would call it in Indian music, we call it avanadha. Anything, a drum covered by with a membrane, either on one side or both sides. This is a khanjira, sort of very simple handheld drum, which is used both in Carnatic music as well as in various folk forms. The next one, what do you think this is? Yeah, this is an aerophone, of course. This is a double reed wind instrument. It's called the algoja. It's actually two flutes. And you can see this very interesting folk instrument where it's played with the pipes inside the nostrils. And it's found in the Rajasthan region. This is the algoja. And finally, this is an interesting one. This is a clay pot, yes, but what kind of instrument do you think this is?
They say idiophone.
Yes, absolutely. So this is an idiophone, or what we call a ghana vadya, where the entire object vibrates. It's a solid instrument. And this is again used very popularly in Carnatic South Indian classical music. All right. And I'm sure some of you may have studied that, you know, this form of classification is credited to a pair of European musicologists called Hornbostel and Sachs, who based their work on an earlier musicologist called Victor Charles Mahion. But he was inspired, of course, by none other than Bharata. In the Natya Shastra, this classification of instruments, Tata, Sushira, Ghana, and Avanadha, is found. And it's interesting that this system of classification applies to all musical instruments created even after his time. So it was clearly based on first principles.
Thank you, Manasi. Can I add something for them?
Certainly, certainly.
You know, I thank you very much for explaining that, because everyone in Western countries say that this is Hornbostel Sachs classification, and they take them for Mahion. And sometimes people forget that Mahion received a collection of musical instruments from Sorundo Mohun Tagore, and from Tagore he had the idea of taking the classification in four groups that came from Natya Shastra of Bharata from ancient times. So our world classification of musical instruments came from India. Thank you.
Absolutely. So with that, I'm moving on now to the last part of my presentation, which is really a little bit of a deep dive into some of the concepts of Indian classical music, right, which is the most codified, defined, structured, grammar-oriented form of music. So clearly there is a lot of shastra or theory associated with this form of music. So what are the basic concepts of Indian classical music, be it Carnatic or Hindustani? There are a few very basic ones, and I'm just going to talk about the top three. And I'm sure you will sort of encounter these more when you go through the next month's, you know, study of Indian music traditions. So this is, consider this an introduction. So before that, I wanted to talk about another fundamental concept before I get into the musicological terms, which is this concept of rasa, right? Which is again very fundamental to the understanding of Indian performing or Indian art, is this concept of rasa. And I, you know, we can simply, you know, kind of try and relate it to emojis that we have. It's a gross oversimplification. But the idea of rasa is a crystallized state of emotion that is invoked in the audience when experiencing a form of art. And this idea of rasa, the rasa theory, is a fundamental concept in Indian sculpture, painting, music, dance, theater, etc. And this again dates back to Bharata's Natya Shastra. There were eight at that time, and a ninth one got added later by Abhinava Gupta. But so there are nine basic states of emotion in Indian performing arts that are elucidated. And these are called the Nava Rasa, where Nava means nine, and Rasa translates to emotion, although it's not exactly it's not a synonym, because let me not get into the details, but there are nine basic rasas which are sort of illustrated here. Again, this is a wall from the IME. So rather than me speak about it, I thought we'll watch a little clipping of a dance presentation that talks about these nine rasas. So this is a very famous Bharatanatyam dancer, Priyadarshini Govind, and there are other dancers as well who are demonstrating these nine rasas.
The nine basic emotions in the Natya Shastra, the Navarasas: love, Shringara Rasa, valor, Veera Rasa, Karunya Rasa, Karunya Rasa, ಅದ್ಭುತ ರಸ. ಲಾಫ್ಟರ್, ಹಾಸ್ಯರಸ. ಫಿಯರ್, ಭಯಾನಕ ರಸ. ರಿವಲ್ಷನ್, ಬೀಭತ್ಸ ರಸ. ರೌದ್ರ ರಸ.
I thought that was a quick sort of 2-minute tour of the Navarasa, and the best way to see that is, you know,
the nine
dance, but you know, certainly it forms part of music as well. So with Navarasa being one of the fundamental concepts, all art is an expression of emotion, and this has been codified in the Natya Shastra. We move on to some other musicological terms. There are basically three terms: swara, raga, and tala. These are the three fundamental musicological concepts. Swara is nothing but note. There are seven notes called the sapta swara. Sapta means seven. Swara is note. And this is a and there are 12 note positions. Now, this is a direct sort of one-to-one relationship with you know, what you would call the seven notes in the Western system as well. So, sa ri ga ma pa da ni do re mi fa so la ti would be an exactly one-to-one correspondence. And again, as you have sharps and flats in Indian music as well, you have two sa. Let me get my key. Sa ri ga. So you would have sa. Then in the re, you have two types. The sort of the lower version, sa ri, the higher version of the ri, then sa ga, sa ga, sa ma, sa pa, sa dha, sa da, sa ni, sa, sa, sa ni da ba ma ga ri sa. Okay, so that's a direct sort of one-to-one relationship. And what is very key here is that in the Indian system, you don't have the concept of absolute pitch. Like, it's not a C, D, E kind of thing. All these notes are relative to the key that you're singing in. And this, we go back to why I say that Indian music is a vocal predominant tradition, right? And that is because, you know, the songs are sung in different keys. So the notes are with relation to this basic tonic note that we call the Adhara Shadja. So while on the left you see this kind of C is Sa, and you know, C sharp is Re, it could easily be F is Sa, and then F sharp would be the Re, the lower Re, and G would be the higher Re, right? So it's relative to the tonic or what you choose as your key. Now, what is key to the way the notes are presented in Indian music is what we call Gamaka, or embellishment of the notes. Whereas in Western music, perhaps the predominant way of singing notes is in the note position as a plain note. In Indian classical traditions, you embellish the way the note is sung. So let me say, so for example, sa ri, you would not sing the ri, sa ri ga ma pa da ni sa, sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa. So what I sang now was a kampita, like where there is an oscillation of the note. Re ga ma. Ma is sung in this particular mode or raga, it is sung flat. In some other raga, you know, some other notes will be oscillated. So what defines Indian music is these embellishments or ornamentations that are given to the notes. And this plays a very key role in defining this next musicological term that we call raga. Now, I mentioned earlier that Indian music, one of the characteristics is that it is melodic or monophonic. And the idea of this melodic identity comes from this fundamental construct called raga, which is a melodic framework. The closest definition would be what you call a musical mode, in which is found in certain systems of music. However, it's not a synonym, as I said. The very basic definition of a raga is a group of notes with certain relationships between the notes. So I've tried to illustrate some ragas on the through the pictures. So again, please note that here it says sa is C, but basically I'm referring to the sort of the key in which you're singing. So so what we see here is sa ri ga ma pa dha ni sa sa ni. Oh, sorry. What would this be? Sa ri ga ma pa dha ni sa sa ni dha pa ma ga ri sa. Sa ri ga ma pa dha ni sa sa ni dha pa ma ga ri sa. So this is a raga that is referred, that is named Kiravani in the Indian tradition. So as you would have noticed, certain notes are, you know, the major or the higher version of the notes, whereas the sa ri ga is the minor version of the note. So one way that ragas are created is by sort of varying which of the notes are selected from these 12 note positions. Coming to the one below here, in this raga called Sriranjani, the pa is eliminated, the fifth note. So is eliminated. So this would be sa ri ga ma dha ni sa sa ni dha ma ga ri sa. Sa ri ga ma dha ni sa sa ni dha ma ga ri ni dha ni ri sa. This is a raga called Sriranjani, right, where the fifth is missing. Then down here you have a pentatonic scale, right? What we encountered earlier. Sa ri ga pa da sa sa da pa ga ri sa. So here you have a pentatonic scale where two notes are eliminated. So you can clearly see how now we are having many permutations and combinations of notes to create various ragas, right? Not just sort of... And ragas don't need to be symmetrical. They do not have to follow the same pattern in the ascending and descending of the scale. For example, this is a raga called Mohana Kalyani, where the ascending is the same pentatonic as Mohana. So it goes... sa ri ga pa da sa. However, on the way down... sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa. Sa ri ga pa da sa. Sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa. Sa ri ga pa da sa ri ga ga ri sa ni da pa ma ga ri sa. Now the rules of the raga are sacrosanct, which means when I'm singing a composition or improvising on this scale, I will have to follow the rules of that raga. I will have to make sure that when I'm ascending, I will eliminate the fourth and the seventh note. Whereas on the descending scale, I will sing all of them together. So we'll see that later on. However, this just these notes does not define the raga. As I said, there's a lot more. There is the speed of the raga, the gamakas, the embellishments. There are a lot of other rules and conventions related to how a raga is elaborated. However, this was a fundamental definition of how ragas are created. Secondly, very briefly, you have the tala or the rhythmic cycle. This is perhaps more easy to correspond with, you know, Western music, especially jazz shares certain characteristics in common. So in the Indian tradition, tala is, of course, the rhythm cycle that one follows. It is defined by the number of beats in a cycle. So a very basic adi tala would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. That's an 8-beat cycle, adi tala. But there are also, each beat can be subdivided into either 4 or 3 or 7. So for example, Chaturashra Nade Adi Tala would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. But a Trishra Nade or a 3-division Adi Tala would be 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, takkitta, takkitta. Then you have a 5-beat division or a Khanda Nade Adi Tala. Taka takita taka takita taka takita taka takita taka takita diku takita taka takita tam taka takita. So 5, you even have 7 again. Takita taka dimi takita taka dimi takita taka dimi takita taka dimi 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 1 2 3 4 5 6 7 1 2 3 4. So you these are the ways that the rhythm structures or talas in Indian classical music are defined by the number of beats in a cycle as well as the number of subdivisions per beat, which gives the characteristic cadence to a piece of music. And finally, in Carnatic music, the rhythm is counted with hand gestures. Me as the vocalist, I am responsible for sort of keeping track of where I am in the cycle using my hand gestures. So as I said, Adi Tala will be 1, 2, 3, 4. So I already know how many beats I am away from the start of the next cycle. Or you have Rupaka Tala, 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3. So this is a sort of 3-4 sort of time signature, or 6-8. I'm not quite clear myself about the difference. So this is very basically what tala is. So I'll come to very last 5 minutes of my presentation before I open it up for questions. And here what I really wanted to do was put all this together in a composition that I will attempt to share with you very briefly. So a Carnatic composition is called a Kriti. Kriti means piece, creation. And the Kriti that I wanted to share is called Shobillu Saptaswara. Now a Carnatic music composition typically consists of a Pallavi, which is like a refrain or a chorus. Then it has an Anupallavi, which is like a small two-line stanza. And then it has one or more Charanas, or sort of longer stanzas, right? So you have a Pallavi, then you sing the Anupallavi, go back to the Pallavi, then you go to the Charana, come back to the Pallavi, next Charana, come back to the Pallavi. That is the structure. So this composition that I wanted to share is composed by this central figure called Saint Tyagaraja. He's one of the Trinity, the three great composers of Carnatic classical music, who lived in the 18th century. Which was interestingly the same time that a lot of great composers in the West also existed. Very quickly, this is what the composition means. I don't want to sort of read it out. I think you can read it. But what I wanted to point out here is this idea of sound itself being divine, right? This song is not about a god. This song is about music being god itself, divine itself, right? It says, praise the beautiful form of the seven notes, Shobilu Saptaswara, right? Pray to the seven notes. Then there's a little bit of musicology. How is sound produced? It emanates from the diaphragm, goes up to the sort of chest cavity, goes to the throat and nasal cavities, and then sound is produced. So he's talking about how music is made in the human body. Then it talks about what we said earlier, right? They shine in the Ruk Sama Dulalo, Ruk Veda, Sama Veda. The origins of music coming from there. And these notes sparkle in the hearts of, the gods and Saint Tyagaraja. So that is the meaning of this composition, which is in Telugu. So let me start. And I also wanted to, say that a composition is not just presented as is, but the musician improvises while presenting the composition. And I will show two types of improvisation. One is what you call Raga Alapana. Which is, this composition is in a raga called Jagan Mohini, which goes like this. Sa ga ma pa ni sa. So you can see again, there is no, it's an asymmetrical raga. It in the ascending it has five notes, sa ga ma pa ni, but in the descending it has six notes, sa ni pa ma ga ri sa, but the ri is sung very close to sa. So sa ni pa ma ga ri sa, sa ga ma pa ni sa, sa ni pa ma ga ri sa. So how would I start this composition? I will first introduce the raga to the audience by, I will not sing the notes. I will sing a free-flowing exposition of the raga using the syllables like a, na, like this. After that, I will sing the composition. Now, this composition is in Rupa Katala, a three-beat cycle. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Shobillu saptaswara shobillu, saptaswara shobillu, saptaswara shobillu, saptaswara shobillu, saptaswara shobillu, saptaswara shobillu, saptaswara sundarula bhajimpave manasa shobillu, saptaswara sundarula bhajimpave manasa shobillu, saptaswara. Maga iva maga ri sa ni sa sa maga pa mani pa sa ni ga ri sa ga ri sa ga ma pa ni sa sa pa sa ni pa mani ni mani pa maga ma pa sa pa maga ri sa sa maga ri sa sa ni pa ma maga ri sa sa ga ma pa sa sa ni pa ma maga ri sa sa ni pa ni sa ga ri sa maga ri sa pa mani pa maga ri sa ni pa maga ri sa ni pa ni sa ga ma pa ni sa ni pa ni sa ni sa ga ri sa maga ri sa ni pa ni sa ga ri sa maga ri sa Gamani ma pasani bhavani sagari sagama bani billu saptaswara sundarula bhajimpave manasa shobillu saptaswara. After that I go to the charana, which I will leave out, but what I wanted to demonstrate was also the finally the kalpanaswara, where I sing spontaneous patterns of these notes. For example, shobillu magari sani shobillu saptaswara gamapa magari sani saptaswara gamabani sani bani bamani bamagamagari sani saptaswara gagamagamagagamagagamasa zaganini
Nizaza nizaga sagaga sagama gama magama papa sagama mani zagaga sagama bama gani zani bani zagama bagama papa mama papa ma bani ni bama ma bani ni bama bani ni bama gaga ma bani sazagaga mama bani ni sazaga sazagaga gama bani zani bama gama bani ma bani Pani za 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 ni ni za 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 ni ni ba ba ma ma ga ga ri ri sa ni sa ga ma ba ni sa ma sa ni ba ma ga ri sa ni sa ga ma ba ni sa ga ma ba ni sa ma ba ni sa ba ni sa ni sa ga ri ri sa ni pa ni za ga 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 pa ni za ga ma 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 ga ma ba ni za ga ma pa ba pa ba ba ni za ga ma ba ma ga ni za sa ma ga ni za ga ri za ni pa ni za ri za ni pa ni za ri za ni pa ni ba ma ga ma ba ni za ga ri za ni ga ri za ni pa ni sa ni ba ma ma ga ri za ni sa ta swara
This is how you would, a very brief sort of exposition of how a typical Carnatic composition would be presented. So with that, I would like to sort of conclude with saying just a few final summary points that I thought would help sort of tie this all together. Just a recap. So I think what I hope one would have got from this is that Indian music is diverse yet connected with certain basic principles. Indian music is traditional and has ancient roots yet is constantly evolving. And of course, the more you listen, the more you'll understand. So we have some good resources on our website. We have some online exhibitions or, you know, just Google Indian music or search for it on YouTube, Carnatic, Hindustani, whatever. And the more you listen, the more you'll understand. So with that, I wanted to end my presentation and turn it over. I hope I have not exceeded time too much, but if anybody had any questions, I'd be very happy to take it.
Oh, thank you very much for this wonderful presentation, which is so big quantity of concepts and themes and arguments and the big capacity of synthesis. You have synthesized the most important things. But I think many questions are there. So let's start with something that you did not understand very well or you are curious about something she said that you prefer to be explained more. Pueden hacerla en castellano, ¿eh? La traducimos. Aunque yo sé que hablan inglés, pues.
I was wondering if she could repeat the Carnatic composition part, because I only have one part.
What exactly?
Que se puede repetir la parte de Carnatic composition form.
Form,
¿no? La forma.
Sí, la forma.
Sí. Ah, la aplauso con el principio. Yes, she was asking if you could, if you could repeat a little something about Carnatic composition form, that for sure is the more difficult part. You have been making the Alapana first, the improvisation, and then when you went to the three parts of the principal part of the raga, Pallavi and Pallavi Charanam, you have been taking the notes, and sometimes you are just singing the notes, which are the son sagradas in the India, and you have been included them in the composition, and then you have been mixing the notes with some text. And okay, perhaps you can explain a little more about that, please.
Okay, thank you so much. Let me try and sort of deconstruct it without. So I'll pause in the middle, right? So I think you understood the part about the rinana, that is raga alapana, right? Where there is no words, it is just a demonstration or improvisation of the raga using the notes, but not saying the notes. You're using a na ta di ra, those kind of syllables, right? Tadarinana. So I think that part is clear. That is called the Raga Alapana, and it comes under the spontaneous improvisation aspect. Okay. So coming to the composition itself, as I explained, and let me do it a little slowly and I'll tell you which part is which, right? Mm-hmm. So the composition has a Pallavi, which is the chorus. It has Anupallavi, which is two lines, small stanza. And then it has Charana, which is the big one. Now, in the composition which I sang, let us see. This is the Pallavi, right? The Pallavi is these first two lines. Shobillu saptaswara, shobillu saptaswara. However, what is interesting is you don't sing this line just the same way. There are what are called, I hope this is not complicating it more, but there are variations of how the Pallavi is sung. And that is called Sangati. There are variations of how the Pallavi is sung. And that is called Sangati. So for example, in this composition. Shobillu Saptaswara. That is the first variation. Then. Shobillu Saptaswara. So the sho is changed. Then. Shobillu Saptaswara. Shobillu Saptaswara. Sundarula Bhajimpave Manasa. So this is all part of the Pallavi. Shobillu Saptaswara. So this is all part of the Pallavi and it has some variations. Now these variations are not spontaneously improvised. They are part of the composition itself. Now whether Saint Tyagaraja wrote those variations or it kind of came along the way. However, we learn the composition with these variations. Okay. So there is the Pallavi which has some sangatis or variations. Then you go to the Anupallavi, right? The second part. Nabhi Hritkantharasana, Nabhi Hritkantharasana, Nasadula Yandu, Nabhi Hritkantharasana, Nasadula Yandu. So this is the Anupallavi, right? Now in this particular composition, let me hit escape here. One second. There is also something that came after the Anupallavi, which Professor Kamara pointed out, right? It is what is called Chitte Swara. So let me share this again. So what happened there was I sang Sa sa pa ni sa ni pa ma ga ri sa ni sa sa ma ga pa ma ni ba sa ni ga ri sa ga ma pa ni. This is also composed. Again, whether Saint Tyagaraja composed it or someone after him added it and that has become convention, we don't know. But we learn the composition with this Chitte Swara. Sa sa pa ni ba ma ga ri sa ni sa sa ma ga pa ma ni ba sa ni ga ma ba ni sa sa pa sa ni ma ni ba ma ga ma pa sa pa ma ga ri sa sa ma ga ri sa sa ni ba ma ma ga ri sa sa ga ma ba sa sa ni ba ma ma ga ri, and so on and so forth. So these are using those sarigama, those swaras which we heard earlier. Again, this is part of the composition or the kriti. It's not improvised. And then you have the charanam, which I didn't sing because of lack of time. But dararuksa madulalo varagayatri hridayamuna. I'm at this part now. Surabhu suramana samuna shubha tyagarajuniyada. Sa sa pani. Again, I will sing the Chitte Swara. Mind you, every composition doesn't have a Chitte Swara. This one does. Sa ni ba ma ga ni ba ma ga ri sa ni sa sa ma ga pa ma ni ba sa ni ga ri sa ga ma ba ni sa sa pa sa ni ba ma ni ma ni pa ma ga. All that comes. And then you go back to the Pallavi. Now, after I finished singing the composition, I came to the Manodharma aspect or the spontaneous improvisation, which I have written here, Kalpana Swara. Kalpana means creativity or imagination. So here this is not composed. This is something that I'm doing on the spot, however keeping the raga framework in mind, right? Like Shobillu Sapta Swara Magari Sanisa Swara Sanipa Magari Sanisa Swara Magari Sanipa Nipa Maga Magari Sanisa Swara. So I can sing various permutations and combinations as long as I keep the rules of the raga in mind. Like I can't sing Sagama Pada, that note cannot come in the raga, right? Because that dha is not there in this raga. It's Sagama Pani. And while going up, you won't sing sa ri ga, you can't sing ri, but while coming down, sa ni ba ma ga ri sa. That is how the raga is. So notice when I do the improvisation, I will keep those rules in mind. Ga ga ma ga ma ga ga ma ga ga ma ga ri sa ni sa ga ma ga. Sa ga ma ba ma ga ga sa ga ma ba ni ba ma ga. Sa za ga ga ri ri sa ni sa ma ga ri sa ni sa pa ma ga ri sa ni sa ga ga ma ma pa pa ni ga ma pa ni sa ga ma pa ni sa ni pa ma ga ri sa ni sa ga ma pa ni ma pa ni ba ni sa za 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 sa ni pa ma ga ri za 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 pa pa ni sa ga ma pa ma ga ri sa ni. So this is the Kalpana Swara, and each time I come back to the Pallavi or the refrain, right? I was doing the Swara at this point called Sapta Swara. Each time I would come back to the word Saptaswara. So these are some general ways that a composition is presented. Of course, there is a lot more. There are more composition forms. There are more ways that improvisation is done. So this is just a general gist that I have given you. Hope that maybe clarified it a little more.
Some other question? Yes, you have a question. I will.
When you were talking about the emotions or the rasa,
when you are talking about emotions, right?
In the video, I think I made one of the emotions. So if you can repeat the that.
No importa, no importa, no problem. I will. Okay, don't care about, because we have we have created a web page on the internet, and you have everything. You have the rasa, you have a talpita, manadharma, sangita, and you have damaka, alapa, etc., etc. Don't care about, no problem. Because you, which was the last one, you, okay, not necessary. Thank you. Porque no sabemos cuál es. No, we don't know which is. You didn't copy. I would like to ask you just something. We are short of time, but I was thank you very much for this. It's so clear for us. But it's something that I always think about. This way of learning Sangeeta, learning music in India, because we here in Western countries, I have been teaching kids in the schools, and we always said for the first day, you have to help them to develop the capacity of repeating what you do, memory, and the capacity of improvising free, just for the first lesson, do, re, mi, mi, re, mi, do, mi, re, mi. But in India, what I saw, I don't know if I am mistaken, is that you are not allowed to improvise. You are just repeating exactly what the master is doing in a very dynamic way. That's true. Lessons are very, very dynamic. But how it happened that after having learning just by repeating and not improvising, after that you finish your studies and you are able to improvise in your special and personal ways. I don't know if there is an answer for that, but for me it's a very question.
It's interesting, and you are right. We spend maybe the first 5 to 6 years of learning music with just Kalpita Sangeet, as you said, which is created music learnt by repeating what the teacher sings. Why do we not start with improvisation right in the beginning? I have not stopped to ask that question, and now that you are asking me, I'm thinking about it more, but I can suggest, or I can think of a few reasons why it's not taught, and then how do we improvise later? Why I feel is because there are so many musical structures to learn that if I think one has to know the rules very intuitively really well before you can start improvising, because on the day one of learning this raga, Jagan Mohini Sa Ga Ma Pa Ni Sa Sa Ni Ba Ma Ga Ri Sa, starting to improvise this raga becomes very difficult, because as you can see, you'll feel like singing Sa Ri Ga because Re comes after Sa, but in this raga it's not there. You have to sing Sa Ga Ma Ma Ga Ri Sa. So while going, you have to skip Re, but while coming down, you have to sing Re. So for these rules and frameworks to get internalized takes a really sort of a long time. Secondly, I think in the initial stages of learning, at least in Carnatic music, I think in Hindustani music, they do start improvising fairly early. But in Carnatic music, a lot more emphasis is on the composition itself. And the ideas for improvisation come from the composition. So the better you know the composition, the easier you can improvise. In fact, the great masters say that good improvisation takes ideas from the composition. For example, you take any composition for that matter, like Sa Ri Ga Pa Da Sa, we took Mohana, right? Mohana Rama is one composition. Nannu Palimpa. So when I start my raga alapana, the great masters will say, take opening line of a composition or some bit of a composition and use that as your takeoff point for your improvisation, like Tadarina Mohana Rama. That idea comes from the composition. So the composition is like a dictionary, an encyclopedia, a reference guide of the raga. And the more compositions and the better you know them, the better your improvisation will be. And how is it that one fine day you're able to improvise? I don't think, it also is taught by the teacher. Initially, the teacher will, you will imitate the teacher in the improvisation, right? He will sing, Magare sa ni sapta swara. Then the student will repeat, Magare sa ni sapta swara. Then the teacher will sing, Gama pa magare sa ni. And the student will sing, Gama pa ni pa magare sa ni. So some slight variation the student will do. So this is how even Manodharma is taught. It's not that suddenly the student finishes learning and learns to improvise. That is also taught by the teacher. And what are the conventions? No, that didn't sound very good. No, this doesn't sound like that raga. It sounds like something else. Maybe you can do this. So there's a constant back and forth that happens between the student and the teacher.
Yeah, perfect. Yes. So very good. We have just no more time, but these 2 hours we enjoyed really. I personally enjoyed really very, very much. My wish is now that we in the future would be able to invite you to Spain, to Valladolid, that you could come here to share with us your knowledge. I think it could be very, 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 very enriching for us, and very, very nice. So Manasi, thank you very much. We wish you the best for the museum, and we have many more questions about what it means to direct a museum so big activity. But perhaps in 2 years we can invite you for another talk with these other issues, which are very, very interesting for us. So thank you again, and we be in touch, in contact, and please, I will just...
Thank you so much, Professor Cámara, for having invited me once again. And thank you all for being a wonderful, patient and engaged audience. I do hope that it has added some value. If you had any questions and that you would like clarifications on or listening recommendations, two ways to reach me. One is email ID manasi@indianmusicexperience.org, which professor will share, or we can connect via Instagram. I'm at Raga Manasi, RAAGAMANASI. So please feel free to connect if you had any questions. And thank you once again. And likewise, I hope to invite you to India sometime and to interact with our community here. And let's hope we can make that happen soon. So thank
with
you.
A very big pleasure. It should be a very good, very good pleasure. So again, nice to stay with you and be in contact. Goodbye. Bye-bye.